I didn't know who Selena was. And I said, well, who was shot? And they said, Selena. And I said, who's Selena? And I started seeing everyone's reactions and the coverage and television. I think it was my own kind of internalized racism that I could not believe that this brown girl had gotten to be so famous. I did not believe it. So that's when I decided to make a film about Selena. I thought it was really important to focus on the family, because the family had like a story to tell.
I think that's what hurts the most, is that she was so giving and so caring. And you know, that there's a lot of people out there that took advantage of her.
Also, I decided to focus on the fans. Her hardcore fans are the very young girls. They saw in her who they could be. Because they couldn't be like the blonde Barbie, so they could be Selena. A little girl may see herself in Selena, whereas an older woman can see, like, you know, something different. And the men, of course, see something entirely different. She is a repository of a lot of ideals, a lot of desires. I think Selena is a complex role model. She's very sexual. And in our culture, to be very sexual is a dangerous thing. I think the most important thing in telling these stories about, you know, Selena and about, you know, Latinos and Latinas is that we need to look at ourselves in the media. We need to see ourselves portrayed. If there had been a Selena to look up to, or a Sandra Cisneros on the television, it probably would have made me feel like I belong in this country. We need to see our experiences validated. Otherwise, we don't exist. And if we don't exist, we have, you know, we become diminished, you know, by the media, and we can't allow for that to happen.
Major funding for POV has been provided by the John D. and Catherine T. MacArthur Foundation to increase public awareness of independent film and video, the National Endowment for the Arts, the Florence and John Schumann Foundation in honor of independent visions on POV, and by annual financial support from viewers like you.
Have you ever heard of Selena?
Selena? Oh, yeah, absolutely. I saw her perform, what, back in 93 in San Antonio at the fairgrounds. She was great.
No me queda más que aguantar bien mi derrota y brindarte felicidad. No me queda más si tu regreso y sería una imposibilidad. Y esto que no era amor, lo que hoy niegas, lo que dices que nunca pasó, es el más dulce recuerdo de mi vida.
You can see it from right here. See? See in between those two palm trees? That's where the room where she was shot.
Confianza que se perdió al grado de llevar a Selena y Yolanda a discutir el 31 de marzo en la habitación 158 del Hotel de Hacienda.
You see it, and then she ran across, on the other side of the pool, she ran across and she ran into the lobby. Now, right here, she passed out right in here.
This is good. Se quería por el día, pero tenía miedo. Se bajó del vehículo dos o tres diferentes veces, ponía un pie sobre el suelo y luego se arrepentía y se metía para atrás.
Las horas transcurrieron en suspenso. He goes, they shot Selena. And I'm like, they shot Selena? I said, where, you know? Why would anybody want to shoot Selena? And she goes, I don't know. They just said that she's on her way to the hospital and that the person that shot her is outside the Days Inn. And I'm like, wow, you know?
La mujer por fin se entregó a las autoridades. Salió del auto sin el arma asesina. Y de inmediato los oficiales se lanzaron sobre ella.
People's eyes, she was just the perfect person. Well, I would be attending them and then they would stop and, you know, more information would come over the news saying that she was pronounced dead.
Well, she was local. She was from Corpus. She was growing out of here, and I think it was me being proud that she was part of our city. And at the same time, someone had stopped her, kind of like stolen from my heart. So I felt something's been taken away from me.
I was like, not Selena. I said, it can't be. You know, Selena had gotten so popular, everybody just loved her to death. And the way I felt like it had been like maybe part of, like as if it would have happened to me. Why, I don't know.
I mean, I used to listen to Selena like way back, and that was really like small because my mom would listen to her. And then for her to like reach where she was and then tragically die at a young age, that's really sad.
Love you, Selena.
How come?
Because we like her.
Because
she's a good singer.
She would encourage kids to take up a career.
Uh-huh.
And she encouraged, she'd go to the schools and sing, like during breaks and stuff, and sing for them and encourage them to continue their education, to become famous.
Thank you.
girls put the Selena Barbie doll in the sand, and they put Kent next to her, looking at her, chasing her. And they didn't really need it, and we took pictures from the ground. I lied on the ground and took pictures, and hopefully they'll come out really nice. Because they said she loved the ocean a lot, so we thought that would be pretty neat.
When I quit the Dinos and moved to Lake Jackson, Texas, it was quite a drastic change for me. You know, I was a night person, a musician, for quite a few years on the road. And all of a sudden, that just comes to a screeching halt. And I would come home every day from work and go to the couch and beat on that guitar. And one day, Selena came and sat down next to me and started singing along. And I was really surprised, you know, that at that age, you know, and she had never heard, I had never heard her sing before, that she had the talent to sing, you know, and that her timing and her rhythm and everything was there. So that's when the wheels started turning in my mind. Ah, a way to get back into the music world. At this time, Selena was about 7.5 years old. Here's some kids that knew zero about music, and you place an instrument in their hand and you try to teach them, and it's just, you know, it was crying time.
And my dad says, hey, guess what? You're going to play drums. And I was like, no, I'm not. He goes, yes, you are. I go, no, I'm not. And I mean, it was like a constant battle with me, and it was very difficult for me. I'm not very musically inclined. I failed, believe it or not, I had failed my music test in my fifth grade, if you can believe that. And look, I ended up to be a drummer.
Y como fanático, como le digo, pues, caray. Dice mi hija, ¿sabes qué, papi? Cómprale unos pinos y ahí, pon tu nombre que tú le hiciste. Y pues, da la cosa como le digo.
I told you, when I go see Selena's grave, and yeah, she was a little girl when I met her. She was very talented, like always, you know. She was very bright and very energetic. Kind of bashful, but then she got over it.
You know, to be on the road, in the bus, in your bunk, her laying right next to you, don't even ask me how we fit, okay? Her laying right next to me and her telling me her dreams and what she wanted. I mean, you know, when you have a sister, you just, you know them so well.
Did you ever meet Selena, Momo?
No, I wish I had.
What kinds of things have you collected from the fans these years?
Her aunt gave me some souvenirs of Selena, and I treasure that.
What were they?
She collect animals like I did, and it was a measuring spoon, you know, real cute with animals, real pretty, and I have that as a memory.
Have you met the family?
Yeah.
Who have you met?
I met all of them.
Oh, really?
Yeah, they're very nice people, very nice.
She was the first one that hit everybody's soul at the same time. The Puerto Rican community, the Mexican community, the Chicano community, all of them together. I mean, you turn the radio, you could hear her, you can feel her. And so that's why her popularity. And then so when she died, she became part of our soul.
Sometimes we see people that we want to be like them, not because of their fame, because of the way they act, the way they act with the people, and we just want to share them. We just want to be part of that, and we respect very deep inside her work and her family. Almost every day we make a tribute of her in our souls, in our hearts, in our minds, and it's an honor to be here taking snapshots of everything. It's very, very special, very special moment.
Have you ever had admiration for another singer like that?
Never. I don't know if I ever will either.
I went to a party that she had. They were throwing away the leftovers, and I remember she asked the guys, "What are you gonna do with all that food?" And they said, "Well, we're gonna throw it away." She says, no, I'll take it home and I'll take it to the homeless. There's a lot of hungry people in this world." And the guy says, "No, because you know, somebody can get sick from it and then they can sue us. So we don't do that." And she said, "Well, she don't know about us Mexicans. We'll eat everything on the way home."
The show we're going to have, the new video, Piras tu Dio, Vas a Llorar, and Solo Tengo Ojos Para Ti.
Also, or Ojos Para Ti.
Wait, yes. I was singing the song there. So,
okay.
No era nada de... Era muy bonita y tenía mucho dinero, pero ella nunca... se hizo ver como muy rica, siempre era muy simple.
Es lo humilde.
Que, sí, humilde, es lo que más me gustaba de ella, por eso.
Y era muy buena hija.
Y era muy buena.
Y ella también es muy buena hija. Por eso no se olvide. La adoramos.
La raza del barrio, you know, the real, you know, the working class children. They all related to them because they relate to this music. The what you call upper middle class or upper middle class Mexican American from this area didn't relate to her because the economic status and that they want to associate with music that the low class people use, right? And the Anglo definitely did not because she was Spanish. But after her death, it seemed like everybody, I mean, there's no barriers anymore.
We're like, what? You know? And, you know, we never really listened to Spanish music up to that point in our lives. I mean, we always listened to the English radio station, you know, and it was like, ooh.
when they saw and they could hear what they were producing, you know, what they were creating, then they started getting the taste for it. They started getting into it and they started liking it.
It's great because I speak Spanish a lot. Not until now, after Selena's death, can Victoria, you know, talk back to me and tell me, you know, exactly what it is she wants, because Selena has, you know, brought this sound to her, that it can be done if you want to do it.
But what was interesting, and we had talked about this kind of on the side, is that it's like that Selena gave these girls a way to have Chicana sexuality, you know? I mean, it's very hot, you know, it's happening. You know, they're like, they're in their bodies totally, they're doing the little, I mean, good dancers, they're really good dancers, and that this whole thing, you know, like there wasn't any of this typical, particularly at that age with that preteen stuff, you know, no vergüenza, they're like, you know, in it and doing it.
Hasta la vida pensar que me olvidaste, saber que en mi decepción me descalló de ti.
Being the sexuality, you know, and these songs, you know, I mean, even the ones that they sang that weren't Selena songs were all these, like, you know, torture love songs, you know, kind of thing, and all about desire and everything. Their little bodies are doing it, you know.
My baby gives me satisfaction. My baby gives me all his love.
From Selena, I realized that you don't have to be just, you don't have to have a certain look or anything. You just gotta try your best. And
a certain look meaning what?
You don't have to have blonde hair, be blonde or.
Cuando escucho esta canción, mi corazón quiere cantar así.
Yes. I really liked also because she looked normal. She was gorgeous, but she had a normal look. She was just beautiful. You know, when I was growing up, I wish I had somebody like Selena to look up to, somebody that looked like me, that looked normal.
Well, here she was more Mexican than American. And over there in Mexico, she was more American than Mexican.
You see, the majority of the stars from Mexico and Latin America are all real light-complected, blue eyes, green eyes, blonde hair. And all the telenovelas, all the stars, they look more like Anglo than Hispanic. And she had, you know, the bigger lips, big hips, the whole works. And people related to that because she looked more like us.
I knew she liked to eat, you know. But she had such a great figure. I remember I asked her one time, you know, as much as you eat and as much as you love to eat Mexican food and junk food, because she said she liked to eat junk food, like pizzas and things, how can you keep such a nice, slim figure? And she was a beautiful girl, you know. And I know, I guess it was just natural, you know. She was born like that.
Oh my God, they gave me cheese.
Show me, take it back.
One more jalapeno. A lot of them.
Well, anybody that is very observant can watch the TV, and you can tell that there was a difference in her body structure, and also some of the magazines mentioned the fact that, you know, she did some cosmetic surgery.
Buenos días, damas y caballeros, ¿cómo amanecieron? How's everybody today? Ojalá que se encuentren bien. Vamos a ver. ¿Verdad ese chisme?
I wanted to say a little bit about Selena. She was a very beautiful person, and, you know, that made me feel great because I'm brown, too, and you know, people tend to change their features, and I thought that she was beautiful. Not only that, I mean, her skin was so soft and brown.
What about her body?
Oh, beautiful.
She had a full body.
I was able to a couple of times put my fingers on her, and I'm not saying that because, you know, I would think otherwise, ¿verdad? But what I'm saying is that she had a beautiful body.
And she had these perfect white big teeth, you know, she was always smiling. Real great. It was good.
I know her mother was very close to her. Marcela was very, very close to her daughter. I mean, I'm not saying her dad wasn't, but her dad was more there to kind of get her, keep her straight and keep her, you know, working all the time. But her mother was always, you know, there for her, you know.
Selena is some way like me because she was brought up with a mom and a dad that supported her how she is, and that's how my parents are. And that helped Selena a lot to go and follow her dreams, and that helps me a lot. And she worked hard at her goals, and even though sometimes she didn't want to practice, she made herself, and I do that sometimes.
I'm like Selena because first of all, she's Mexican American, and she sings her songs with feelings, and that's how I sing my songs, and she's funny.
And
look at all this beautiful stuff, you know, that's happening with these girls. And partly it breaks your heart because you realize that, look what happened to Selena.
I watched her videos a lot. A lot of that got me crying too much and got me sick, so I quit listening to her music, but I'm back and feeling better. But I still listen to her music, but not as often, but I am a Selena fan.
Well, Selena was like, I'm like Selena because I went through the same thing she did. I mean, if I didn't have an outfit, I'd go buy one then in the last minute. And I'm not a Selena fan. I'm not a Selena fan, but I have Selena keychain. Because the only reason why I have her on a keychain is because I went to the Stop and Shop here, the little gas station there, and it's the first time I ever saw a Chicana on a keychain that wasn't the Virgen de Guadalupe, and I had to buy it. But I don't have any Selena records, and when they asked for commentary when she died, I never listened to her songs. But I have to say, I have her here, and there's some things she stands for that I think is very dangerous.
Like,
you know, like she dropped out of school. Her father had her working when she was in...
She did.
He made her quit school.
She was in junior high.
They were with her father and their mother. They were out of trouble. You know, they weren't hanging around with the wrong crowd, getting into problems. They became successful. They enjoyed what they were doing. So they made something out of their lives.
Young people to go up there and be sexy and be 12-year-old sexy child up there singing with your little bustier. I'm sorry, that's not a model that I would want for a young woman or for anyone related to me or a child if I had one.
I think that's a good point.
And the fact that, you know, you have to, the only out is you have is to be this sexual being singing songs that aren't even that wonderful. You know, that's the only outlet we have here. And that you have to die before you're 25 years old. That makes you successful. That's how you get on the cover of Texas Monthly. You either get, you know, bludgeoned, raped, or shot. And if you're Chicana, that's the only way you get on the cover.
Into the Bible by the concepts of the Bible, and we show, you know, all the way from the Abrahamic covenant on all the way through Jesus, all the different really, really cool financial principles that are in the Bible. So if people want to get that, that will be out in the summer, and hopefully it'll do really, really well.
And for the first 2-3 years, you know, sometimes there were weeks that I would only give A.B., Susanna, and Selena maybe $10, $20 a piece, because there was nothing left after we paid the expenses, you know, the other two musicians. And I remember one time that they got depressed, you know, because they would see the other musicians getting the money, and they were over here with nothing, you know. And they said, Dad, you know, we don't want to play anymore, you know. And took them to Ocean Drive, where $4 or $5 million homes are, you know. And I took them and drove them over there and said, you see these houses? One of these days, you're going to be able to own a house like this. You're going to have 18-wheelers. You're going to have a bus.
Selena Quintanilla.
Female Vocalist of the Year.
Selena Quintanilla.
Selena Quintanilla. Once again, Female Vocalist of the Year, Ms. Selena Quintanilla.
This is out to you, honey.
In San Antonio or in South Texas, other than our mothers or that certain tia we had who gave people hell, we didn't really have strong, we didn't have role models at all from our own culture. You would never hear them joking around in Spanish. All of that was a world that was invisible and was not talked about, did not exist, was kept in the closet. Maybe your sexuality wasn't in the closet anymore, but still your basic roots were still in the closet. And Selena had a very, very big part of it where people were just like, I am someone. I am this area I come from, I'm just as, can be just as glamorous as anyone else.
Somebody to run the store because we were always on the road. So Yolanda came into the picture. She was the president of the fan club.
Yolanda was my good friend. She was so good that she was stood up at my wedding. At one point, she was really in with the family. She started calling Selena, you know, a little here, a little there, and I can do this for you, I can do that for you, and you know, just being a friend.
Because Selena was a Jehovah's Witness, she went from the stage to the trailer. So it was like, you know, you don't drink, you don't do anything, you don't party, you know. So the dad had very strict controls on her. So she goes, and so then she marries somebody who's in her band, you know. The guy lives right next door to her, right? So it's a very circumscribed, and Yolanda becomes her confidant.
You know, my parents would protect us, you know. We had always had somebody to protect us, you know. And here's Selena, you know, not knowing and trusting. Selena was very trusting.
I grew up with this thing in my mind of protecting my family. And so they grew up as adults, never venturing out of this family circle. So I guess in a way, maybe there was a little... They were naive about a lot of things, you know.
Selena wanted more or less to cut down on her entertainment. She was very interested in designing her clothes, but because father did not want to let go negative energies and things like that happened.
When my kids started doing their own business over here, I didn't meddle into Selena's business or Abby's business or Suzette's business. They're adults. You know, they're starting their own thing. Let them learn. You know, and maybe, I look back now that maybe Yolanda didn't see me going in there and helping Selena. So that was her chance of going in there and says, hey, I'm here for you.
I would tell Selena about Yolanda, little things that I would know, and she'd be like, you know, no, Suzette, you know, blowing it off.
Then some of the employees, they would tell me that Selena's here, she's very sweet. As soon as you or Selena leave, boy, she turns like a devil.
And I told her, just be careful. Just be careful, because I don't trust her.
Here you have a person that's not popular at school, don't have friends, physically is not a good-looking person. All of a sudden, she gets put in the limelight. She can make checks. She's got a sense of power now. I became aware of the embezzlement, and I showed it to Selena. I remember Selena said, Dad, really? It doesn't sound right. So she started checking things out. Then she started seeing the discrepancies. You know, so we called the meeting to confront Yolanda. And Selena fired her right there that same night. She told her that she couldn't trust her anymore.
Yolanda felt that she was being pushed out of their reality for whatever reason. And there's a lot of rumors on that too.
Mm-hmm.
But she was being pushed out and she was trying to hold on. And I think that she snapped.
A flash of metal caught Selena's eye. Yolanda had a gun. She was pointing the gun at her own head. Then the gun turned and went off.
One of the reasons she had that gun and everything went crazy and the ring got thrown on the bed, and Yolanda died. I mean, Selena dies with the ring in her hand. I mean, my, por favor. She dies with the lover's ring in her hand, and they were not lovers.
Who knows what goes inside a person's mind? Was she obsessed with Selena? Yes. I believe that 100%.
Selena is not a lesbian.
No, but neither is Yolanda.
Well, people presume this.
Right.
This. But, you know, can't you just have a friendship with a woman, a very intense friendship with a woman, and you can love a woman and it has nothing to do with sex, or, mm-hmm. you know, that could be your girlfriend. And it doesn't have to mean it's your novia, it's your girlfriend. And I really like the story, because to me it's a story about her finally finding some support of separating herself from her father's house. And that's what I see. And I really see that, you know, Selena is this person in the middle of this tug of war between her father and her best friend.
You know, Selena was a woman and also a child in her mind, you know.
I think that's what hurts the most, is that she was so giving and so caring, and that somebody could take, you know, Yolanda took advantage of that. You know, there's a lot of people out there that took advantage of her, and Yolanda being one of them, and, you know, it just hurts.
You know, in the many years that we were in the road and traveled to so many cities and all that, my biggest worry and concern was that some of my kids being hurt at this event, you know, because sometimes a vibe breaks out, somebody pulls out a gun, and that was my biggest fear. And look what happened. Right in my backyard, this woman came and killed my daughter.
Brought it here for her?
Yes.
Could you read it?
Okay. Dear Selena, I really miss you, and I want you to come back and sing for everyone. In my room, I have lots of posters of you, and you look really pretty. Guess what? I'm gonna sing on August the 31st. I really like singing. I want you to come. Give me the luck and help me. Sorry, dude. Give me luck and help me. Will I give you this letter so you would know that lots of people love you enough to write you letters and water your grave. P.S. I love you, Michelle.
That's a beautiful letter. You want to put it there for him? To myself.